Martinez, the most famous American Indian potter, was best known for the black-on-black pottery that she and her husband, Julian, perfected in the 1920s. This film is vintage 1952. Here is the sign to the Pueblo in New Mexico, about 30 miles north of Santa Fe, off the road to Los Alamos. San Ildefonso Pueblo lies in a valley by the Jemez Mountains near the famous Black Mesa. An old cottonwood tree is at the edge of the plaza. Maria's oldest son, Adam, and his wife, Santana, live here by the two-story kiva. Maria stands on the kiva steps, dressed for a ceremony in her white buckskin boots and her red Hopi sash. The dance begins with a male chorus led by a drummer. Watch their feet. Notice how often the rhythm changes. This is probably a corn dance in the fall and praise of crops. This Pueblo has four dances a year that outsiders can watch, but probably there are really many more. Children learn to dance almost as soon as they can walk. The women are barefoot, wear tablita headdresses, and everyone carries greenery for everlasting life. Several times during this day-long ceremony, dancers retreat into the kiva, where Anglos are never permitted. We can surmise from old kiva ruins at Monument Valley and elsewhere that kivas are deep into the ground. Here Maria comes from her own house with Nora Eccles Treadwell, who gave the art museum to the university and whose husband is making this film 50 years ago. Maria said she was born for people. She talked about her pottery to everyone in her native Tewa language or in Spanish or in English. The Pueblo pottery process is the same today as it was in 1952, as well as hundreds of years ago. The clay is gathered from sacred place on the reservation, and then it is ground fine on a stone matate. White volcanic ash, also found on the reservation, is mixed 50-50 with red clay to prevent the pots from blowing up in the bonfire. When water is added, the ash makes the clay sticky and gives it a crumbly texture that makes it very difficult to work with. The high alkaline content of the volcanic ash causes it to become soft and wiggly if the clay is handled too much. Natural, unrefined materials differ all the time in the ground. With the ceramic process, it is never possible to see colors of clay or metallic oxide pigments that are used for decoration until after the firing. Mother Earth materials do not look the same in the raw state as they will look after the firing. Maria rolls the clay into a big ball ready to work with. For instance, it takes about this much clay to make a pot this size. Only as much clay as can be used is mixed at one time. Maria loves to put pots on her head to show how women carried pots of water and grain in the old days. Making any pot begins with the clay saucer you see in front of Maria, which is called a pukki. It has a raised foot inside so that the base of the pot will be indented to fit on someone's head. Maria flattens a pancake of clay and lays it in the pukki for the base of the pot. She pats it down well into the form all the way around. And she pinches up an edge ready for the first coil. Maria was probably the most skilled of all Indian potters of her generation at making really large pots. She gets more clay in good condition. And rolls the coil between her two palms. She adds it to the base, pinching it together with the base, moving her fingers inside and outside to thin the wall and to make the pot taller. She rotates the pukki in both directions. More coils are rolled and added, pinched on and up while she turns the pukki around. No Indians in North or South America ever used the potter's wheel. All pots have always been made by hand for thousands of years, unlike most other cultures in the world that did use the potter's wheel. Even if they wanted to learn to use the potter's wheel, these Indians wouldn't do it because preserving tradition is so important to them. Hand building has been their tradition for thousands of years. Southwestern Pueblos in the United States are the last remaining Indians to hold on to their traditions. She smooths the wall inside and outside with a specially shaped tool cut from a gourd. She raises a cylinder shape first, and then with her hand inside, she pushes out and in again to shape the curve that she wants. She indents the edge to be ready for the next coil, turns the pukki always to keep the bowl symmetrical. Maria won a prize at the Chicago World's Fair for having 99% perfect symmetry on a big pot. She makes the surface here as smooth as possible as she goes along. This particular form could be a finished bowl, or more coils could be added to continue it up into a tall jar. After the pot is totally dry, it will be scraped smooth with a tin can lid and then sanded with sandpaper to make it even more smooth. The quality of the surface now is important to the burnishing process at the end. Making pottery by hand, as Maria is doing, takes great sensitivity. She must feel the thickness of the wall all the time to keep it even, as well as to keep the pot really round. Traditional Indian pots are supposed to be perfectly round. An uneven wall thickness may cause a pot to crack during the drying or the firing. Often pots are made that don't live through the whole process, but Maria never missed. You can see how meticulously skilled Maria is and how fast she works. No other American Indian potter ever worked as large, as fast, or as prodigiously as Maria. She picks up the pot now and then to look at the profile of the shape she is creating. It wasn't traditional to sign pottery or to call attention to oneself. Maria didn't sign pots until the museum people asked her to. She never did attach value to her signature and even allowed other women in her pueblo to sign her name on their pots. All pots at San Ildefonso that will be fired black or red are coated with a liquid clay slip that has more red iron oxide in it than the clay body, so that there will be a better color. The slip must be polished quickly back and forth before it dries with a smooth rock, usually handed down from grandmothers or aunts. Maria was an expert polisher. Polishing is crucial to the look of the shiny black pottery. It took Maria some years to learn how to polish with a rock rather than rubbing with a cloth as she did for the polychrome pottery. Only a small area can be slipped and polished at one time. Polishing a big pot is much more difficult. If the slip dries, the pot will be scratched by the rock. Pots were usually not polished on the inside. This is the finished surface, and no glaze was ever used. She's showing you that the slip has dried, and she has to stop polishing. The design is painted on the polished surface with another clay. The brush is made from the frond of a yucca plant that has been chewed for several days to make it supple. Maria outlines first, and then she fills in. Usually, Maria didn't paint designs on her own pots. She preferred to use her sister's years ago, then her husband Julian, and when he died, her daughter-in-law Santana, and then her son Popovide. This is the firing area behind the house. Wood ash on the ground from previous firings, shovel, metal plates, all the tools necessary for the primitive firing. They keep these same metal plates and tools year after year, firing after firing. Maria begins to stack her pots on the metal grate over the piles of juniper wood that is really the fuel for the firing. She turns the pots upside down. Pieces should touch as little as possible, and she tries to keep her fingerprints off the polished surface, handling them only on the edge, because fingerprints would show after the firing. The pots are stacked one level high. Metal plates protect the pots and create air vents. Tin cans under the pots aid circulation. Cow chips that have dried about a year are placed over the mound for insulation, like the bricks of a kiln. It takes several hours to load and build this bonfire kiln. Small pieces of dung are placed on top. This closes the top of the kiln tighter than on the sides where the air is controlled with the metal plates. During the firing, the metal will be shifted to give a supply of oxygen to the flame. Maria lights the mound all the way around, and instantly flames leap up through the pottery. It's the volcanic ash mixed with the clay that keeps the pots from blowing up. The fire burns about 45 minutes at bonfire temperature of 1300 degrees Fahrenheit. Maria keeps monitoring the fire from her years of experience and waits for the fire to consume the existing wood. As the fire burns, the cow chips turn black. Maria adds more juniper wood to keep the fire at its 1300 degree temperature as long as she thinks necessary and moves the metal plates to ventilate it. She prods the fire to make sure the process is consistent. At a specific time that only Maria can fathom, dried horse manure is poured on to smother the fire, which will make the red pots turn black. Maria's youngest sister, Clara, 30 years younger, helps. Maria and Clara continue to pour manure. When they see smoke rising, they fill the holes. Smoke must stay inside the kiln to develop the black. Firing in this primitive fashion takes all the intelligence and ingenuity that a potter can muster. The whole process, from digging the right clay, grinding it, through making the pot correctly, polishing perfectly, can be ruined by an improper firing. Notice that the day is calm and there is no wind. They are shoveling ash over the manure to keep the carbon from the smoke contained. Since Julian died in 1943, Maria and Clara have been continuing to work as a team at this perfected process. Over the years from 1920 on, Julian and Maria experimented to make the black firing better. The first bonfire has to be just the right heat, the horse manure have just the right amount of carbon in it, and the smothering must take place at absolutely the correct time. This is a fantastically intuitive operation that took them many years to perfect. Maria checks the color and the shine of the pots with what she calls her poking sticks. It's not ready, so more ash goes on to contain the smoke again. Now out come the shiny black pots at exactly the right time. Left in too long, the finish will become dull. The red pots are now black due to a process that we call carbon deposition, where the iron ion in the clay is exchanged by the carbon ion in the manure and the smoke. Maria wipes off the sticky wood ash while the pots are hot. Maria and Julian were asked to make black pots after a Smithsonian dig in 1908 uncovered black shards from 2,000 years ago near the Pueblo. The museum people told Maria how other ancient cultures had smothered pots to blacken them. Because Maria's tradition was polychrome, which was light background with colored decoration, she couldn't believe that black pots were traditional to San Ildefonso. Eventually, Dr. Hewitt at the Museum of New Mexico convinced Maria and Julian that black pottery was their heritage also. Then they began to perfect the polishing and the firing of their black pots. And Maria said, "Well, black goes with everything." John D. Rockefeller was brought to the Pueblo by Dr. Hewitt to see the black pots. Maria still didn't think she should be making black pottery instead of the polychrome. But Rockefeller bought 8 pots, and she was convinced. Maria loved to travel to other Indian powwows and to world's fairs. She and her family spent a year at the San Diego Exposition. She was in San Francisco when they built the Golden Gate Bridge, and she laid the cornerstone for Rockefeller Center in New York City for the same Mr. Rockefeller who bought her first black pots. "I like people," she would say. "I don't hide." Maria is dusting the ash off the pots and looking at the designs with Mrs. Treadwell. Popovi Day, Maria's second son, arrives to take the ladies to his shop where he sells pottery. En route, Maria stops to show a carved pot with the design of the water serpent god, the Avanyu. "I think this pot is an experiment, or even from another pueblo, because Maria didn't carve. It is said that Julian revived the ancient symbol of the water god." Maria's daughter-in-law Santana says Julian was a real artist. She passes by her adobe bread oven and shows Mrs. Treadwell some old cooking pots that are not polished and not decorated, but blackened from use. The women feel the wall thickness and the weight of the pots that have served the Indians so well for so long. For thousands of years, Indians made cook pots that were undecorated, but were actually quite beautiful. After turning the pot around, as she always did, to feel the evenness of the wall, she puts the old cook pot on her head to show that she can still maintain her balance. Then she shows a really beautiful polychrome pot on her head that was decorated by Popovi Day. They proceed to Poe's shop. And he shows Mrs. Treadwell a beautiful big black pot that Maria made. Here's another black pot with a reverse curve at the neck that's very difficult to polish, which won first prize at the Gallup Fair. Maria had hundreds of prizes in her lifetime, and she took prizes year after year at the Gallup Fair and Santa Fe Indian Market. Maria made red pots, not smothered with horse manure, and polychrome pieces like this one decorated by Julian, which is now in the Museum of the American Indian in Santa Fe. In the early days, sometimes Maria's sisters, Anna and Desideria, painted for Maria, especially on the polychrome. That is the white background with the colored clay pigments, or the black on red pots. Here are two of the earliest black on black pots, made about 1915. Contrasted with this 1935, much more sophisticated pot, painted by Julian, and actually over 2 feet tall, which is now also in the Santa Fe Museum. I made this audio recording of Maria and her oldest son, Adam, in 1973. This is the signature before Julian died in 1943. Marie Julian. When Popovi Day began to paint, he asked Maria to sign Maria, which she did. There is no record of Maria's birth, but perhaps she was about 100 when she died in 1980.